ask you to bear with me. I'm going to try and take you on a ride. But I want to share some things with you that I believe that are happening right now, that we have to be aware and we have to be ready. So I'm very active on social media, usually on Twitter. You know, people post things and I comment things and all that. And one of the things that I've been noticing lately is a lot of people either using scriptures they don't understand to shame Christians for saying something when they disagree with a government program, or saying that Jesus was a socialist and using scriptures to justify government welfare. So I got into this exchange a few days ago with this lady that replied to a comment, a question I asked someone else, because some lady said, well, Jesus was a socialist. And I said, would you mind providing me scriptures that support your claim? And instead of telling me, she actually blocked me, so I couldn't see her profile anymore, which doesn't surprise me. But this other person did reply to my question, and the scripture that she gave was, when the rich man came to Jesus and said, Lord, I do this and this and this, what do I have to do? Well, give up your riches and follow me. And he got sad and walked away. So I said, okay, nice try, but that's not what the scripture is about. Well, he's telling him that he hates money. No, he doesn't. What he's saying is, if you love money, then you're not going to get into heaven. That's a different thing. So we went back and forth, and then she switched to James. I think it was chapter 5, maybe, when he says, oh, you rich people, that you have taken advantage of others by not paying them their fair share or keeping their money, something like that. I don't remember the exact scripture. And I said, nice try, but that's not what the scripture is about. So we went back and forth, and I got to the point where I said, this is not going anywhere, so I'm just going to ignore this person and just go about my day. But that's something that I see constantly. You know, people keep saying that Christians are hypocrites when they oppose some sort of government welfare program, and instead they say, let people pick themselves up and something like that and stop taking my money to give somewhere else that does not want to do anything. And it's kind of a trend. I don't know if you saw on the news recently, there was a politician that was using a scripture to oppose some sort of welfare program that was being pushed. And the scripture that he used was, in the Bible it says, let the one that doesn't work not eat. So then people went after him. Look at this guy, you know, doing all these things or whatever. And I was talking to someone and I said, that's not what the scripture is about. It's for the person that refuses to work when they can. It's not a person that's not capable of doing work. I mean, what kind of person would we be if we see someone that cannot do something on their own and we just say, I don't care, just do what you have to do? No, that's not what we're called for, that's not what we're about, and that's not who we are. But all of those things are attacks that we're having right now because of all the things that are happening. And I think it's very important that we are aware of those things. And as I was thinking about those events and what to talk about, there's two things that came to mind. And one is from Psalms chapter 68. And the first verse says, God shall arise, his enemies shall be scattered, and those who hate him shall flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so you shall drive them away. It's talking about us. Mm-hmm. Why? Because we have the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Mm-hmm. I know I'm not a Bible scholar, but I've had revelation, so I know when to stand my ground. So that's what I was doing. So I was driving them away. It says, as wax melts before fire, so the wicked shall perish before God. But the righteous shall be glad. They shall exult before God. They shall be jubilant with joy. Sing to God. Sing praises to his name. Lift up a song to him who rides through the deserts. His name is the Lord. Exult before him. And then the other thing that came to mind is from the book of Isaiah. And it's chapter 43. And we've sung about this several times. It says, but now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned. And the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Mm-hmm. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Bring out the people who are blind, yet have eyes, who are deaf, yet have ears. All the nations gather together and the peoples assemble. Who among them can declare this and show us the former things? Let them bring their witnesses to prove them right, and let them hear and say, it is true. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I declared and saved and proclaimed when there was no strange God among you. And you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. And also henceforth I am he. There is none who can deliver from my hand. I work, and who can turn it back? Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake I sent to Babylon and bring them all down as fugitives, even the Chaldeans in the ships in which they rejoice. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings forth chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Who are those that are called? We are. We have already answered. So now it's our responsibility as children of God, as soldiers in this spiritual army that we're in, to go out and witness and minister to those that have eyes but can't see, that have ears but they can't hear. Those that are trying to attack us, let's not attack them back, but rather speak to them and let Christ shine through us.
Yes.
I'm a firm believer of a saying that goes, reason does not yell, why get into a screaming match with someone that does not understand what you're talking about, yet is trying to use it against you to try and prove a point? Just listen to the person and then just talk to them. Let the Holy Spirit give you the words.
Yeah.
Don't try to use your own reasoning, because otherwise the conversation is not going anywhere and God is not going to be able to move in that situation. So let's just be aware of these things that are happening. Let's stand our ground. We have the weapons that we need,
yes,
to counter these things, to defeat them. We already have the victory. So let's just go out and make sure that this victory that we have is manifested and shown to others.
Amen.
So they can come to Christ as he's calling them.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Any prayers, requests, testimony? No? Tally. Anyone else? Yes.
Just remember, Dan, I'll probably maybe say something again on Sunday, but a week from today, he's having surgery on the bottom of his foot, but it just goes smoothly and without a hitch and a speedy recovery.
Amen. Speaking of surgery, actually, I don't even know why I didn't bring this up. My dear wife, Kelly, actually has to have surgery on April 24th. We go to the hospital. She's gonna have a procedure to deal with some issues that she's been having as we try to expand our little family. So these issues are preventing that from happening. But I am confident that, I actually believe that when we get to the point and they check her again, they'll be like, what are you doing here? You don't have anything.
Yeah.
I truly believe that. And
yeah,
and I really want that to happen, because it's going to both minister to her and the doctors.
Yes.
Amen.
So that's what we want. But in the chance that it does not get to that, I know God's going to give the wisdom and he's going to guide the surgeons as they're doing what they're supposed to do. So let's just pray for heard that everything goes well, and hopefully it doesn't have to get to that point.
Right, amen.
Mike.
So, let's break, he had his gallbladder out. It was oversized, and it was full of stones.
Wow.
It was full of stones, and that made him obviously uncomfortable, but as many stones as they're talking about, it should have been more uncomfortable. So, usually, gallbladder surgery, you're out in 48 hours, whatever. Well, they're talking 4 to 10 days because of the issues he faced with it. So
wow.
Keep lifted up. And Nancy also, but she's staying in that for him as we will also.
Amen. Anyone else? Okay.
I want to look out my very gentle.
Amen. All right, well, let's stand. Let's come to the Lord, the Savior.
Praise
Father,
God.
We thank you,
Jesus,
for bringing us here to be gathering your name. We thank you, Lord, for the word that you give us, the word, Father, that we declare into every situation of our lives, and that situation change for the better, for the intended purpose, Lord, that you have given us that particular word to speak. And thank you, Lord, because you have called us and we have answered your calling. And because of this calling that we have answered, Lord, we are now know who you are. We have experienced who you are, Father, and we can go out into this world and share with people who you are as well. Maybe that encounter that they have with us is the only encounter they're ever going to have with you, Lord. So we ask that you use us as your instruments of peace to bring forth revelation, Lord, that you have given us to share with others, Father, that you are calling but haven't answered your call. We thank you, Lord, for always being with us, for your mighty hand upholding us, protecting us, Lord. When we fall, we know that you lift us up. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for all of your blessings, for the sacrifice that you made, Lord, sending your only Son into this world to come and die for us so that we would be reconciled to you. Thank you, Father, for the gifts of the Spirit that you have given us, Lord, when you gave us your Holy Spirit. Father, let us go out boldly into this world and show people who you are. Continue to guide us, Lord. Let not our reason be what speaks, but rather your Holy Spirit, the words that your Holy Spirit will give us to speak into any situation. Father, I ask right now, take in your hands those that have been brought up to you for whatever the need, for healing, for restoration, for a breakthrough, Lord. Because we know that you are a faithful God and that all the promises, Father, that you have made us will come to pass. All we have to do is agree and believe that what you said will come true, will come true. We stand in your word, Father. We speak it and declare it in our lives and the lives of others that are in need. For their eyes to be opened, their ears to be opened, their spirit to be shaken, and their heart to be changed and transformed. So their lives are renewed and they come to experience the joy that comes from knowing you, Lord. Thank you, Father, giving us this opportunity, for revealing yourself to us and showing us who you are. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Please turn off your phones if they're on and not on vibrate or put them on vibrate. And okay, so this Saturday, April 8th, there's a prayer burn at Harlan Church in Ankeny. We're going to be there. There's a lot of things that are happening that are manifested, that are manifesting. And, you know, there's a hunger and visions are being given. I had one earlier this week, so if it's going to come to pass this Saturday, I really hope so. I have a really big desire in my heart that the way that I do and lead worship changes, because I don't know if it's a matter of confidence or what. But there's something that I'm really waiting and hoping that happens. Because I've talked to Mike about this before. I know that I play guitar all the time, but I really want to get to the point that I can just grab the microphone and let loose. So.
Amen.
Tear it up.
It's going to be good. All right. Hallelujah. And then next Friday, a week from this Friday, we're going to have our Eastern Gate House of Prayer. And are you seeing anything? Or?
Absolutely. It's Good Friday. Let's focus on what the Lord has done, what has gone on at that time. So I don't remember having a Good Friday service here. We will have that as the atmosphere of what the Lord has specifically had done on that day. Just circle around it and enter in. Just love on them. Just love on them. Just love on them. Hallelujah.
All right. And April 22nd, the first ever Women of Confluence, Influence.
First
Yeah, I was gonna say that, but I was like, well, I don't want to put Suzanne in a tough spot because if it doesn't happen, then it's my fault. But let's just call it out. First Annual Women of Influence, Women's Conference, Daughters of the King.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. So it's gonna be good. Better than Bethel.
The biggest one we've ever done.
Yep.
Salute.
All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, and your
people
may rejoice in
you.
Praise
God.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created its function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Ron, would you mind taking the offering, please?
Thank you. turn the mic on. So, but I remember someone told me once, you be careful when you argue with a fool, because sometimes it can be confusing to people. Who's the fool? You know, because there is another saying that goes, you argue with a fool, you have two fools arguing. Praise the Lord. I'm not accusing you of that, Roberto. I'm just saying. I don't get on Facebook, and I don't do any of that stuff, because I'm afraid somebody out there will remember me from years ago. There may still be a warrant out for me someplace, and I'm not taking any chances. Praise the Lord. Anyway, God is good, and we're grateful, amen, for His goodness. And I was kind of torn tonight about what to preach on, so I may just be wandering all over the place, but if I am, you can just, hopefully you'll wander with me. Praise the Lord. But I know a while back, you know, we were talking about how sound is so critical. You know, in fact, when in the beginning, you know, God said, light be. That's the actual translation. We read it, let there be light in the King James, but he wasn't asking for the light to come. He was declaring the light. He said, light be. And the fact is, light is and has continued from that moment on at 186,000 miles per second, and it continues to go. The universe is expanding. That's scientific truth. You know, it's not just my opinion, it's just a reality. It continues to expand ever since God spoke it. Amen. So whatever God has said, in fact, the truth is, they say that if we had the ability to develop a receiver, every sound that's ever been made, every voice that's ever spoken, it's still out there. We just don't have a way of collecting it. And it's kind of weird, because a couple of weeks ago, our dog had a lot of issues. It had diabetes. It had some tumors on its pancreas and some other things. So we had to have it put to sleep. It's a nice way of saying we had to have it killed. And that was kind of depressing and sad, and still is, because, you know, you get used to having them around, and they're not there all of a sudden, and it just, you don't realize how much interaction there is with them until they're not there anymore, you know, and then it gets to be kind of depressing. But anyway, a couple nights after that, Sally and I both, we didn't say anything at the time, we didn't mention it to each other at the time, but both of us heard him bark in the house. And I'm not talking about, we didn't hear a dog barking around the outside because there's other dogs around. I literally heard him in the house bark twice. I heard it, and then she heard it, and then we mentioned it to each other the next day without having any conversation about it. Both of us had heard it. Now, I know that's weird and freaky, but here's even weirder. This morning, I woke up really early. It's like 4 o'clock. Couldn't sleep, so I got up. I went upstairs, and I was praying, and I was looking over some things in the Bible, reading and so forth. And I was just about to doze off in the chair, and I swore I heard Sally say, "Hey!" And I said, "What?" And nobody answered. But I know I heard it, you know. I mean, I heard it in my head, is what I'm saying. So, you know, what I'm saying is, words are powerful. Sound is powerful. In fact, I taught here, oh gosh, I don't know, several years ago about on quantum physics. I'm not a physicist, but, you know, I can read. It's a great blessing. And talks about, you know, when I was a kid going to school, the way they defined an atom or broke the atom down was different than it is today. Then it was just, you know, the protons and neutrons and the nucleus and so forth, and that was it. Well, today, now they have, because they have these colliders, these things that can, you know, create the speed of the atoms and cause them to crash and split into even smaller particles, they now have broken it down to where there's even what's called quarks, which is a smaller subatomic particle than anything they've ever found before. Now, I mentioned that they, within that quark, are sound waves. So if you think about it, everything is made up of sound. Everything's made up of atoms. Nothing exists that doesn't have atomic basis. Matter, all matter, has atoms in it, right? So everything is created or exists because of sound. God spoke this into existence. This thing here, it's atoms. It's really not solid. It just seems solid to us. And the truth is, if you break it down to its smallest denominator, it's sound. And what's even more interesting is, within this study that they did, when they would look at the quarks through these super magnifiers, they would see that some guys would see, or some scientists would see, that the sound in them were wavy lines. And others would see just a straight line. It was sound, but it was different. And what was so weird about it was, as they began to research this further, what they found out was it was wavy lines to the scientist who expected there to be wavy lines. In other words, they had predetermined that these sound waves would be waves, where another hadn't made that predetermination and thought, well, it doesn't have to be. I mean, you know, if you look on a, like, just think of a hospital monitor where they have the blip, 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 or the bzzz, it's still sound. It's just one is just, you know, waves, and one of them is just a flat line. So the ones who were expecting it to be a flat line saw a flat line. And the ones who were expecting it to be waves saw waves. Now you say, well, what does that mean, Nathan? Well, what it means is the sounds, these things, are responding to our thoughts.
Yes.
So think about that for a while.
Yeah.
Now, I said that for this reason. The scripture says that out of your mouth you declare. In fact, it even says that with the heart you believe, but with the mouth confession is made when it comes to salvation. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You can't be saved without sound.
True.
You got to say something.
Yeah.
So you believe it here, and then you speak it. Okay? So I want to, that's kind of what I want to talk about. So in Genesis chapter 1, you don't have to go there, Roberto. I'm going to just wander around here a little bit till I actually get to a scripture. But in Genesis 1, it says God spoke. In the beginning was God, and he spoke, right? He spoke, light be, and light was, and it still is. Amen? Then he goes on, and he creates mankind in his image. And he gives them, I mean, this is all basic stuff, but I'm just kind of going on here. So then he creates man in his image, and he gives him dominion over every living thing. Now, first of all, the only thing that really, or I shouldn't say the only thing, but the main thing that separates us from the rest of the animal world outside of, you know, having a soul is the fact that we can communicate, we can speak.
Yes.
I know some of you think your dogs are talking to you, but, I mean, it's like a cat. I always say, you know, Sally, look, and the cat's sitting there looking out the window, you know. And she said, wonder what he's thinking. And I'd say, nothing. And they're not self-aware. He's just looking out the window, you know. But my point is, we can communicate. We can talk. We can. We have the ability to speak. That's what. That's one of the things that makes us like God.
Yeah.
No other creature can do that, and that's why we have dominion over all the other creatures on the earth. Amen. And if you think about it, God made us a speaking spirit. Made us in His image, like He is. Amen. So our spirit in us is the eternal part of us, and it goes on forever. And we have the ability to speak. So God brought all these living things, all these things that he created, everything, every creature on the earth that he created, and he tells Adam, you have dominion over all of this, and then he brings them all to Adam. And he says, name them. So whatever Adam named them, that's what they were. Now, what they were before that, they were something, but they didn't have an identity. They weren't definable or identifiable until Adam spoke. And God gave him that ability. God gave him that authority to do it. Declare what these things are going to be, right? So that's what Adam did. So Adam names them, and then they were what he spoke them or named them. That's what they became. So God had given one rule, one law, you could say, in the creation. And that was, don't eat from the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. Everything else you can have, it's all yours, you get it. But don't eat from this one, because right now you're innocent. How many of you would like to be innocent again? You know, before you had guilty feelings or bad thoughts or any of that kind of stuff. Just innocent. That's the way they were. They were innocent because they didn't know good from evil. There wasn't any rules. There wasn't any laws. I've heard somebody say one time, why didn't, if Eve, you know, wanted to eat the See, the only thing that devil could do, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but the only thing the devil could use against Adam and Eve was a law. That he couldn't tempt them without there being something that said you can't have this.
Right.
I mean, they wouldn't, what was he going to tempt them with? Everything else was theirs, right? So there was one rule or one law, and that law was do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So the enemy comes, and he comes to tempt them to do the one thing that God said not to do.
Right.
And I've heard it said, well, why didn't she just shoot Adam? Why didn't she just kill Adam? Because there wasn't any law against it. Right? I mean, it wasn't sin to kill Adam. The only sin was to do the one thing that God said don't do, right? So that's what the devil came against it with. So he tempted her, and what did he tempt her? He tempted her to do the one thing God said don't do. So he came against the Word of God. This is how it all starts. This is the way it works all the way through humanity. To this day, when the enemy comes to tempt you, he tempts you with what God has said. Hath God said? You know, he'll come and say, you know, that thing you said to your wife, or that thing you said to your husband, or that gesture you made in traffic, or whatever it was. You know, you don't deserve God to do anything for you. You're a hypocrite. You're a phony. It's like what, you know, non-Christians are always saying. You know, they're just hypocrites and all that. It's mainly because they don't understand Christianity in the first place. But the point is, the devil always comes with accusation, right? He tempts you to get upset and to then act on that attitude, and then he crushes you for doing it. Well, see, God never wanted there to be this opportunity for Satan to come against you, to be able to manipulate you. And that's why he said, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. As long as you're innocent, he's got nothing he can use against you. He can't shame you. He can't make you feel guilty. He can't make you feel like a failure. He can't make you feel like a hypocrite. He can't do anything to you. So all that Satan has done from the garden to the very present is the very same thing. He comes, the Bible says he is the accuser of the brethren, right? Now here's the deal. The scripture says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So the devil's got to get you to sow some stuff. He knows how the kingdom works.
Yeah.
He's got to get you to sow some things that he can use against you.
Yes.
Because he knows whatever you're saying is what you're going to end up getting. Okay? Now, let me make it a little clearer here. Roberto, let's go to Mark chapter 4 and verses 14 and 15. Or actually, Mark 4, 13 through 15. See, we have made Christianity about everything except the kingdom. And when Jesus came, what he came to do was to preach the kingdom. He's the kingdom is near you, it shall be in you, and so on and so forth. And we've made it about all kinds of stuff, but we've missed the main purpose of what God was doing. He's still wanting us to have dominion.
Yes.
Jesus came and redeemed us from the curse of the law and from all the failure of man all the way back to Adam, so that we could have dominion again, so that we could bring the kingdom of heaven to earth, so that we could bind on earth what's bound in heaven, and so on and so forth. So he said unto them, know ye not this parable? How then will you know all parables? And in other words, he's saying, if you can understand this parable, you'll be able to understand all of the parables. And the sower soweth the word. The word. Everybody say the word. Amen. Okay, so the sower sows the word, and these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. But when they've heard the word, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. Have you ever, how many times have you prayed or declared your healing or confessed healing or a financial breakthrough or whatever it is, and immediately the enemy comes and says, that ain't going to happen. It can't happen. Because look at your mess. Look at the doctor's report. Look at what the bank said. Look at the latest statement. There's no way this can happen. He immediately comes and tries to steal the truth of what God has put in your heart.
Yes.
You say it, and immediately he comes, right? So these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but when they've heard, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. All right? Let's look at verses 30 through 32 now. Same chapter, Mark 4, but verses 30 through 32. So then he goes on to say, and he said, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or how what do you compare the kingdom of God to? It's like a grain of a mustard seed, which when it's sown in the earth, is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it's sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all herbs and shooteth out great branches so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. Now we already know that we sow the word, that the word is seed, right? That's what we read back in Mark in chapter in verse 4, right? Or excuse me, yeah, verse 4, 13 and 14. So here's the seed. Now on the pages of this Bible, it's like a mustard seed. It's just a little thing, right? Because anybody can pick this book up and look at it and read it, and it doesn't, I mean, you've got atheists that read it, that can quote scripture, but they don't believe a thing. So it's just a little thing until it's sown. When you sow it, and you sow it by speaking the word, right? So when you sow it, all of a sudden, it gets big. Why? Because you've got authority. You are the thing that sows this thing into reality. For those of you that have ever lived on a farm or been around farmers or had a garden or anything else, you know, he talks about this, that even in these same scriptures, if I'd have backed up a little bit, that the farmer, you know, he goes out and sows the seed. He puts it in the ground. He goes to bed. He gets up. He goes to bed. He gets up. And then all of a sudden, bang, he sees stuff coming up out of the ground. He doesn't have to have gone to Iowa State agriculture school to know how it works. He just knows if I get it in the ground, it'll produce after its own kind. That's just what it does. It's natural for it to do it. That's what he's telling us. We can be just like an ignorant farmer, you might say, or a stupid gardener. Just put the stuff in the ground, the rain comes down and waters it, and it starts growing. I don't necessarily know all the biology of it. I just know that pretty soon tomato seeds start producing tomatoes, right? That's what he's saying. You don't have to have perfect theology about this. You just got to get the seed and speak it.
Yes.
And it'll produce.
Yes.
Didn't he said, my word will not come back to me void.
Right.
It comes down like the rain and the snow out of heaven. And he said, if I can find somebody to speak it back, in other words, if somebody will receive that word and then declare that word or speak it back, he said, it will produce what I send it to produce.
Exactly.
See, there's a lot of the word here that isn't producing, not because it isn't powerful seed, there's nobody sowing it.
Exactly.
It's just tiny little mustard seeds because it's just laying here, still in the package, right? Praise the Lord. So when you sow it, it becomes great. It begins to produce after its own kind.
Yep.
All right, how many know Jesus is the Word,
yes,
right?
Yep.
The Word became flesh.
Yes.
Amen? All right, look at Romans chapter 10. And verses 3 through 10, Roberto. Romans 10, verses 3 through 10. See, you know, we're saved by grace. We're delivered from judgment through faith in grace. And it's actually not even our faith, because if you look in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, it says it's the gift. We're saved by grace through faith, which is the gift of God. And we always say, well, grace is the gift. No, it's grace is the free thing that God gives us, but you can't access grace without faith, and so God gives us faith. Faith is a gift from God as well. He gives us a measure of faith so that we can receive grace, right? So we have been delivered. We Christianity is not about us getting delivered. We've already been delivered. If you're a Christian, if you're a believer, and we spend half of our time because of religion trying to get re-delivered. Because we're always screwing up, right? We're all human, and we're always making mistakes, so we're always trying to fix the mistakes instead of living in the reality that we were sinners, but now we are the righteousness of God in Christ because of His grace.
Yes.
So we don't have to think about that stuff anymore. We've been delivered from the curse of sin.
Yes.
We've been delivered from the law,
yes,
the curse of the law, which is guilt and shame and all that stuff because we still screw up.
Sure.
We still sin, but we're not sinners.
Amen.
Does that make sense? Look, we were sinners when we were born. The moment we burst forth from our mother's womb, we were sinners.
Yes.
Were we not? Because we were after Adam. We didn't have to do anything to be a sinner. You just had to get born. Well, once you're born again, You don't have to do anything to be righteous. I'm not saying we don't want to be righteous or don't want to do good things, but I'm saying that the criteria isn't on what we're doing. The criteria is the fact that we have been born again. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, you've got to be born again. You've got to be born from above. Because what is earthly is born in the earth. Right? So you've got to get born again. Well, all right. So if we just, I can't get into all of that, but if I'm just saying, if that's the case, and we know it is because of what the Bible says, then our focus should be on operating in the kingdom more than it is about keeping things right. Everything's been made right by Jesus. I can't add anything to that. Spiritually speaking, which is what got born again, was my spirit, I'm as good as I'm ever going to get. You say, well, that's scary. But you don't, because that's only because you don't understand that my spirit is exactly like Jesus. It's perfect. It can't get any better than it is, because it's just like God. If it weren't that way, God could not dwell in me. Amen? Amen? So here's the problem. The problem is I'm always being measured by this. I measure myself by this. And so I'm always subject to the enemy's attack against this. What you said, what you thought, what you did, how you acted, what you know, your behavior, and all these other things that keeps you in guilt and shame, subject to questioning whether God will do what God has said he'll do because you haven't been good. He's checking to see who's naughty and nice, man. I mean, he's got a list, right? That's what we think. We think he's like Santa Claus. He's not. He's way better than Santa Claus. He has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And he's not taking it back. He's not, you know, dangling out here and saying, geez, if you just could get your act together for 24 hours, Nathan, you can't imagine how I could bless you. No. You are blessed. Yes. The problem is I undermine my blessing by listening to the devil tell me what a jerk I am. Yeah. Amen? When God is not judging this anymore, it's already been judged in Christ. Yes. I was in Christ when he was crucified. That's what Paul said. Yes. I was crucified with Christ. What was crucified? My flesh was crucified with Christ, and I received his spirit in return. He took my flesh, my sin, and I get his righteousness, his spirit. So now I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Now, religion will even take it even further and say, well, yeah, when you're in Christ, but you're not in Christ half the time. Yes, I am. I can't get out. I can't separate. I will never leave you nor forsake you. He can't separate himself from us. Once you've been born again, you're born again. Now, I can act stupid and make bad choices and so on and so forth, but it doesn't change my relationship with God at all, because that relationship's always been about spirit to spirit. Yes. They that worship me will worship me in spirit and in truth. It's just that we got a body, because it's the only thing that makes us legal on this planet. Amen. So we've got a body, and that gives us access to this atmosphere, to this realm. That's why God had to be born into flesh, because he's a spirit. He was illegal here without a body. Right? And he came to redeem us back to him by the Spirit. Okay? Now, I got way off in that, but I'm just saying, because we're making everything about stuff that isn't really what it's about, and it's undermining what God is trying to do in us and through us. Okay, so back to Romans 10. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going to establish their own righteousness, which is what I'm talking about, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. So as long as you're trying to be righteous, you're not submitting to his righteousness. You're undermining what he's done. It's frustrating, is what the Bible, another place it calls it. Paul said, I do not frustrate the grace of God. So for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. In other words, Jesus came. Now, rules will never make you righteous. No matter how many you keep, it won't make you righteous. It's the end for the law to make you righteous to everyone that believes. For Moses describes the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which does those things shall live by those things, shall live by the law. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend to the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith that we preach. That if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. There's the whole picture of Christianity in a, you know, encapsulated, just in a nutshell, basically. All right? So we don't have to go anywhere to get Jesus to come. We spend a lot of time praying, Lord, come, Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord. And we're trying to get Jesus to come, right? We're trying to get God to show up on the scene. Amen. That's what he's telling us here. You don't have to do that. You don't need to go anywhere to try to get Jesus, the Word of God. Why? Because the Word is nigh thee. It's in you. Jesus is in you. The Word of God is in you right now, even in your mouth. So if you want Jesus, pick up Jesus, the Word of God, and start speaking Jesus, and he shows up.
Yes.
Instead of waiting for some ethereal, vaporous, you know, thing to show up on the spot and make it happen, how about just declaring the reality of him into the situation? You release God, you release Jesus into that situation or that circumstance. You declare his word is above, right? He said his name is the name above every name. And it says in the Psalms that God elevated or exalted his word above his name. Now, that's almost counterintuitive when you think about it, because Jesus and the word are one and the same. But all I'm saying is this. His word and himself cannot be separated. You received him by the word of God, right? You, by hearing, you received it into your heart, and then you confessed it with your mouth. It came in, and you spoke it out. Everything in the kingdom works the same way. That is like the ABCs of salvation and how the kingdom of God operates. Okay, so Christ in you, the hope of glory, or the Word of God in you. Speak it, and Jesus, the Word, will save you, right? Confession is made unto salvation. That word salvation is sozo. It's completeness. It means everything. It doesn't just mean escaping hell. It means whatever your need is, here it is. So you receive Jesus, the word, and you speak it, and what happens? You get what you need. The first time you needed forgiveness for sin. You needed to be delivered from your past life, from your old self, right? Every time we speak Jesus, every time we speak the word, now it's for other things. We're saved now. That's not the issue. The problem is now I'm saved, but I'm sick.
Yeah.
I'm saved, but I'm broke.
Yeah.
I'm saved, but I got relational issues that are all fouled up. I'm saved, but I got other stuff happening that I need help with. So I speak the word just like I did to get the initial salvation or save from hell. Now I speak it to save hell from stealing everything that God has given me. Because the truth is, when I got born again, I didn't get born again so that I could then go out and try to get this stuff. I got born again and all this stuff was already in me. If I got Jesus in me, then I have, he says, the kingdom was with you and it shall be in you. In the kingdom is everything that I have need of. See, because Jesus, who is Jesus? He's the healer. By his stripes you were healed. So I've already got healing. I just got to speak. I got to release it. Amen. I got to know that I have it and that it's available to me and that I have a right to it. Jesus became poor that I might become rich. I have all the money I need. I just got to figure out how to get it from here out here.
Yes.
And how does that happen? By believing and then speaking. Find the word of God that declares that and then speak that.
Yes.
Right? Hallelujah. He opens the windows of heaven and pours out a blessing I can't contain.
Yes.
Everything I set my hand to prospers. No weapon formed against me will probably, I mean, that's what we're doing when we're confessing this stuff before each service. Not because it's rubbing a rabbit's foot or something, but to get us acclimated to that's the way the kingdom works.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, speak it. Whatever the need is. Completeness, okay? All right, John 1, 1 through 3. John 1, 1 through 3. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Same was in the beginning with God, and all things that were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Everything that was made, we already talked about at the very beginning, everything that exists because of a word. Because of the word of God. All right? Verse 14 says, that word that created everything, put on flesh. Still the word, but now it's in a human form. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's true in John 1, but for us, the word became flesh and now dwells in us. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen? And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Praise the Lord. Words carry spiritual forces. Or God wouldn't have spoke everything in. Or they wouldn't have said that the word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. Amen. Words, and we know this in the natural. Words transmit fear, or words transmit faith. I was telling a story a couple weeks ago about the grandkids were over and we were running around. I had them back in our bedroom, and there's a walk-in closet, and the bathroom's right here. It's all in that area. Had all the lights off. They love, you know, getting a flashlight and running around. You know, kids. And I left freaking them out. So they had a little glow stick thing. One of them did. So there's two others, and they wanted obviously something too. So I got one of them had a little lantern. And then the youngest one, I had told him to go out to Sally and get the flashlight. So he comes back in, and we're going around and around. I'm thinking, this is an ideal time. This won't happen again. Now I read them Bible stories and stuff, but this was a... So I get Tom Sawyer out, and I say, I'm going to read a story to you. And, of course, it's Injun Joe, the freakiest one in the whole bunch. You know, the scary. And so Sally came in, sat down. We had them all in the bed there. And I'm Injun Joe, and I'm really getting... animated and just really going through the whole thing. The flashlight, no matter how freaky you look freakier when that flashlight's under your face. I'm doing all this. And this kid is just, the two older ones are not so bad because I've freaked them often enough that they're kind of used to it. But he's like not quite four, and so he's, this transformation that's taken place. Popo is now Injun Joe. And so I'm saying, words transmit spiritual forces, transmit fear, and they can transmit faith. We know that just in the conversations we have. The kids come home, they all tell me, it's okay, kid. Listen, you're going to do all right. I know, you're not dumb like the teacher said you are. You just had a bad day. Everything's going to work out. It's going to be fine. And they, before the, very long, they're fine. They're just being themselves again, and everything's cool. If you tell them, you idiot, I told you, you're so stupid, you'll never amount to anything. Now they're freaking out, and tomorrow the test will be even worse than the test I had today. Why? Because we're transmitting spiritual forces.
Yes.
Amen? So, they transmit words, transmit fear and faith. So, look at this in Roberto, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4. 2 Peter 1 and 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. Amen? Look at this again. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. Those are words, right? That's the promises that are in the Word of God. That by these words, you might be partakers of the divine nature. Words transmit God's image. I'm not making this up. I'm just reading the Bible. I'm just saying that's how simple it is, and yet we have, it takes a preacher to complicate this stuff, to make it not understandable. You almost have to try to twist it. It's really just a paraphrase of, with the heart you believe and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. What happens at salvation? You become one with God. So by these precious promises, we become partakers. We are receiving God's image or God's reality into our life. And that's why we need to do it, because the battle we have is between these images.
Sure.
Satan's trying to get us to reflect or trying to cause us to believe that we have his image. based on the way we act sometimes or the things that we say, instead of the reality, which is we have the image of God, and that cannot be taken from us. So he is the accuser of the brethren. How does he accuse you? By always coming and telling you, you know, God's not going to bless you. You're too screwed up. You make too many mistakes. You've turned your back. You've done this. You haven't believed. You didn't trust enough. You didn't do this enough. You didn't do that enough. Right? So it's all these are words, and they're coming, amen, to develop an image. Demonic or godly. Amen. All right, Romans 10, verse 17. I'm not taking too long for you all, but I told you I had several different ways to go here, and apparently I'm going in all of them. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes by this. Fear comes by the natural realm,
yes.
The doctor's report,
yes.
The angry husband, the upset wife, you know, the lawyer, the banker, fear, and the enemy just builds on that. You'll never, you know, you deserve to go broke. You don't manage your money right, anyhow. So you deserve to, you know, go under. And so your husband leaves you. You deserve it. You've been a jerk. Your wife goes off and leaves you. She ought to leave you. You're an idiot, right? The doctor's report. Terrible thing. Well, you deserve to be sick. You're a jerk. You just don't live like you're supposed to live. That's the devil. That's the enemy constantly. Where God says, by my stripes you were healed. Amen. Whatever you set your hand to prospers. All of my relationships flourish. Me and my house will be saved. Amen. See, that's what I'm saying. That's the battle. That's the fight. And if you don't use the word of God, you have no weapon. You're helpless to what the enemy wants to do. And half the people that we all deal with them, that are so down and so depressed and so bummed out and wondering where is God in all this, have no clue that half of the reason that they've got the issues is because they're not using the things that they have available to them to defeat the enemy. They're not really resisting the enemy. They're just caving in and going, well, I guess I do deserve it because I am a jerk. Not according to God. You are the righteousness of God, and you have every right to the inheritance of Jesus Christ. Everything that Jesus has coming is yours.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right. So faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So fear is actually faith in the devil.
Yeah.
If you think about it.
Yes.
It comes by hearing anything that contradicts or is contrary to the word of God. That's what fear is. Because there's nothing in here to scare you if you understand who you are. All right? 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 13. See, we're supposed to be overcomers. The devil's supposed to be afraid of us.
Yes.
Amen? And he's got us buffaloed into being afraid of him. And that's not right. It's not supposed to be that way. See, people think, oh, well, God's withholding from me because, you know, I don't deserve this. Yes, you do.
Yeah.
Jesus put you in a position where you deserve everything that's in this word.
Yes.
So God isn't withholding it, and the devil really doesn't have the power to stop it unless you agree with him.
Right.
The enemy can't stop it, and God won't stop it, is what it comes down to. He lies, the enemy does, and accuses and gets you into guilt and to shame and to fear. And God says, say what I say. You're the righteousness of God. That's what Jesus did. What did he do? He used the word of God. When the enemy took him out after he was, it was revealed that the Holy Spirit was upon him, so on and so forth, and his ministry was activated, and he goes out immediately into the desert, and the enemy comes, the devil comes and says, here, jump off this building, or do this, or do that, and I'll give you all this stuff. And what did Jesus say? Oh, no. Don't make me jump. No, he said, it's written. He just used the word of God. He just spoke the word of God. And what does it say? The enemy left him. The devil left for a season. Which is what the scripture tells us. Resist the devil. How do you resist the devil? You can't just go get under the covers in the bed for a day or two. No, you're going to have to resist him, and you resist him by the word of God. And when you resist him by the word of God, he'll flee.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean he won't come back, but then if he does come back, you do the same thing, and he'll flee again. Okay? So we have the same spirit of faith according as it is written. I believe, therefore I have spoken, or I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak. So you can transmit the spirit of faith with words just like the enemy can try to get the spirit of fear to you with words. You have the same ability. You got to use it though. Amen? Romans 8, 2. Now, this is interesting to me. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free. This is Paul talking. He said, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. All right? How did that Spirit of life that was in Christ Jesus get into Paul? Verse 15. By God's word. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again unto fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. He got it by the word of God.
Yes.
All right, Mark 4:24. And he said unto them, take heed what ye hear, with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you, and unto you that hear shall more be given. So what you hear affects you. You don't want to listen to everything. Praise the Lord. Some things you just need to. Na 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 na. I'm not listening to this. You know, it's crazy. All right, Luke chapter 1 verse 12. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Go on. Just continue. Through verse 15, 13, 14, 15, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. Praise the Lord. This is not Luke, is it? Sorry, I want Luke 1, 12 through 15. It's good scripture, and it's not really bad. It fits here, but not quite the way I wanted it to. So when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. Remember Zacharias? That's John's father. He's an old guy, and he's not supposed to be able to have kids. He's kind of like the Abraham of the New Testament. He's old. His wife is old. She's barren. They can't have children, right? And so Zacharias saw him. He was troubled. The angel came and told him, your wife's going to have this miraculous child, right? He was troubled and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. Verse 18. And Zacharias said unto the angel, how's this supposed to happen? I'm an old man, and my wife is an old woman. I'm paraphrasing, all right? So here's a guy, now just, here's the analogy here that I'm trying to make. Here's a guy who heard a word from God, right? God said, you're going to have a son, he's going to be mighty in the eyes of the Lord, so on and so forth. But what happened? He didn't receive it. He said, the odds are too great against this happening, and here's why. I'm old. She's old. We haven't ever had any kids. How am I supposed to believe that now we're going to?
Yeah.
Because God said. But that's not what he's responding to. See, he's responding to God's word in the natural.
Right.
So he doesn't receive it. So Zacharias says, basically, how do I know you're telling the truth? I mean, I need a sign. I need something. The word isn't going to be enough for me. See what I'm saying? Now, we've already determined that Jesus is the word of God. So apparently Jesus is not enough. Think about this now. What are we saying when we say, well, you know, I really screwed up, and so God's probably not going to bless me today because I was really bad. And what I'm saying is, what we're saying is, Jesus isn't enough.
Exactly.
I need something more than the Word of God that came in the flesh. So this is, that's the metaphor that's being played out here. So look at Luke chapter 1 now. Luke 1, verses 19 and 20. And the angel answering said unto him, I'm Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. Amen? If Zacharias didn't shut up, this wasn't going to happen. He has been given power. His words have authority. So the angel's saying, you're going to be struck dumb because if you keep talking the way you're talking, what I've declared that God has sent me here to declare ain't going to happen. So if we have the Word of God and we're saying, well, that ain't going to happen because, you know, this is bad and that's bad and this thing is that. God is saying, what God is saying a lot of times is if you can't agree, just shut up. Because you'll stop what God wants to be the reality in your life. You'll stop it from happening by declaring things because you've got authority. So if you're going to say stuff, say either say what this says or don't say anything at all. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Zacharias didn't conceive that word. He's unlike Mary, the mother of Jesus. What did she do? She conceived, the word became flesh. She just believed. The angel came and told her, you know, you're going to have a child. It will be the result of the Holy Spirit. God will overshadow you and you're going to have a child. She said, be it unto me even as you have spoken. How did she conceive? She believed. So she conceived that word. She believed that word. This wasn't intercourse. I mean, that's a whole other thing going on here. This is something totally spiritual. God did it by his word. She believed it and conceived it. He would have not conceived. In fact, he didn't conceive it because he was arguing against it rather than receiving it. So you conceive the word. Praise the Lord. So if you want to conceive healing and you are having trouble believing it, shut up. Just keep quiet until you can get your faith to the place. Continue to read it, continue to confess it to yourself until you can get to the place where you can declare it. Amen. Faith is the ability to conceive what God has said, what God has declared. That's what faith is. That's how you got saved. Somebody told you Jesus died for your sins. And you believed it and said, I believe Jesus is my Lord and Savior.
Yes.
Salvation.
Yes.
That's the way the whole kingdom works. All right, John 6, verse 63. John 6, 63. It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. This is Jesus, right? The words that I'm speaking, he said, they are spirit and they are life. So there is, here's what he's saying. There is spirit life in God's word.
Yes. Yes.
But it has to be received. It has to be conceived in the human spirit. And that happens when we believe it and say, we read it and we say, I believe it. You received spirit life. You received Christ in you. That's how you did it. Spirit words, the words of the Spirit, which are spirit and life, were spoken to you, or you read them, and you received them, and conceived that truth. And you received a spiritual reality. Spiritual power came to you. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 1, verse 23. We'll wrap up here. 1 Peter 1 and verse 23. So being born again, not of corruptible seed, which is just natural talk, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So you were born again, just what we just said, right? by words, the word of God. Incorruptible seed. Seed that can't be defiled. Seed that can't be hybrid, can't be messed up, can't be mixed up, can't be crossbred. Can't, it's just pure, incorruptible word of God.
Yes.
Amen? Liveth and abideth forever. Spirit life, right? And you transmit that same image that God has of you into your spirit when you say what God says about you.
Yes.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because you have authority. Yep. What you say counts. So if you're saying, I'm a jerk, I'm a dope, I'm an idiot, this ain't going to happen. Guess what? Things don't move along very well in the kingdom.
Right?
Right? You're not unsaved. You're just not getting any benefit in this life of salvation.
Right.
You're going to have to wait to die before you get anything.
Yeah.
And he's saying, if you'll speak what I say about you, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. In spite of the fact that I look in the mirror and think, you lying hypocrite, it's not about that.
Yes.
It's about what he said. Either what he said is true or it's not true. If I receive it, I conceive it, it becomes my reality. Amen?
Yes.
I'm transmitting the image that God has of me into my spirit.
Yes.
Amen? Everything that you receive from God enters into the spirit. That's where it's conceived. But you have to make a decision to believe God. All right? Ephesians 4, verses 29 and 30. I'm kind of repeating myself a little bit, but it's okay, because the more it's, faith comes by hearing, by hearing, by hearing. It's continuous. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. We've always thought that meant don't be swearing, don't be cussing, don't be, that's probably a good idea. But really what it's talking about is don't say stuff that contradicts this. That's corrupt. We are born again of the incorruptible seed, and if we start going out here and spreading corruptible seed, we're undermining the reality of what God's saying about us, right? So that's what he's talking about. Don't let corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. That's why when in the New Testament, under the New Covenant, when you have prophets that come and prophesy, if they come prophesy in doom and gloom, I just, you know, there's the door, because we don't need it. Whatever coming out of our mouth ought to edify. It ought to lift up. It ought to encourage. That doesn't mean we're not being realistic, but just like what Roberto said, we don't have to say everything we think. Thank God. We'd be in jail if we did. But, you know, sometimes you know that's just stupid what they said. But that's not going anywhere. That's not going to take you anywhere with that person. It's not going to help anything. So the best thing is just don't say anything. Don't let any corrupt communication. Just try to find something positive to say and go on from there, okay? So don't do that. So you can minister grace to the hearers, which is just favor. Just, it's okay. We're all right. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. So here, fear comes by hearing words of the devil. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. I have the capacity to release the devil's words as easily as I can, and sometimes easier than I can God's word. I have to make a decision. The words I want to release for my life and for the people that I care about, and honestly should be for everybody, are the words of God.
Amen.
Even if they cut me off in traffic for a moment,
yeah.
I might release a couple of words from the devil, but I repent right away, praise the Lord. I'm continuously covered by the blood, hallelujah. I know that doesn't happen to anybody else, but I'm just trying to be real with you so you feel more comfortable, praise the Lord. All right, Romans chapter 10, verses 6 and 8. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, all right? So, Romans 10, verses 6 and 8. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. That's us, our righteousness. Our righteousness is of faith, not by works of the law. So the righteousness which is of faith speaks this way. Say not in your heart, who's going to ascend into heaven? That's to bring Christ down again. Who shall descend into the deep? That's to bring Christ up again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith that we preach. What saith it? So what are you saying? Light be, or man, it's dark in here. You see what I'm saying? We don't have to go somewhere to get God to show up. We just got to say what God says. And that's the reality. All right? Last scripture and we'll quit. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Whereby again are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. By his word we obtain what the word says. That's our nature. We are born of the word. Right? Born of God. So we say what God says, and it reveals our true identity. It reveals our image. Plus, it provides for all of our needs. The scripture says in another place that all these, God has provided for us all things that pertain to life. Your car, your house, the bills, the, you know, food, clothes. He's provided all things that pertain to life and godliness. I mentioned, I don't know, last week sometime or something, I don't remember when it was now, but, you know, we say things like, the scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, which is what we're talking about tonight, and his righteousness, which is not my works or my keeping the rules and everything else, but just by faith, receiving Christ, I receive the righteousness of God. And he says, because he's been talking about clothes, food, this thing, that thing, and the other, but he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, what we're talking about tonight, and all these things will be added to you. If you go, check this out, get a Strong's Concordance or Cruden's or whatever, and look up that word things, and what you'll find out is it means words. All these words will be added to you, and these words are what provide everything that God has for you. See, it really is simple if we don't try to complicate it. There's a steady, continuous stream of God's consciousness throughout the Bible. It's only when we start chopping it up to fit our denomination or our particular, what we've already believed or some other thing. See, it's like at some point we have to just do what God told me to do about 25 years ago, and that is put that down, and the next time you pick it up, read it like you've never read it before. And that doesn't mean like, wow, I'm really going to read this thing. No, it means read it like you don't have any preconceived idea about what it's supposed to mean. You don't read it through your denominational glasses or the prism that says this is what it meant and that's what it meant. See, that's hard to do. It takes intellectual repentance. If you understand what I'm saying, you can't be afraid to read this and say, I wonder, could it mean that? God's not going to send you to hell because you get another interpretation here. He's given you the Holy Spirit to lead you and to guide you. If you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit. You can't not have it if you're born again. If you believe God, that's what we got when we got born again. His Spirit came to live in us, regardless of anything else. How that manifests is, you know, that's independent, that's individual stuff. But I'm saying God will never leave you or forsake you. He wants you to understand.
Yes, he does.
But you got to be willing to take some risk. And that means most of the time you got to do some intellectual repenting. You got to say, I know that's what I've always believed, but maybe he means something else. And what happens is, and I bet you've already figured this out, when you get a revelation, in other words, you know, you read the scriptures and you've read some of the same ones over and over and over, and all of a sudden one day you read it and you go, wow, never seen that before. And you read that scripture hundreds of times, but all of a sudden now it has a different meaning. It, not that the meaning changed or the original meaning didn't change, it's just that you went a little bit deeper and you go, whoa, I think maybe he's talking about something beyond that, you know. That's what he wants us to have, is revelation. But the only way you can have that revelation is by opening yourself up to whatever he wants to tell you. And then what happens is, if just like in that case where you say, wow, I never saw that before, once you do that, once that happens, then you start seeing, whoa, here's a confirmation of that. Here's a confirmation of that. Here's another place in the scripture that tells me that was what I, that really is what he's talking about. You see what I mean? Because all scripture is given by inspiration of God. So it all, there is a flow of the Spirit that is consistent. It's just you got to be willing to let go of some of the stuff that we've all got. And I'm not saying I've arrived. I got to do it every time I pick up the Bible, because I still got to, ways I could say it, but a whole load of stuff that I picked up over the years from denominations I was a part of and church I was ordained in and all that stuff. And it isn't all wrong. I'm not saying it's all wrong, and I'm not saying even believing it's going to send you to hell. It's just it'll keep you from moving further and further into what God has for us. This is a journey, and it goes on as long as we're here breathing air. We're supposed to be continuing to have revelation. God's revealing himself over and over and over, and his word and he are one, right? God bless you. Thank you for your patience tonight. The Lord bless you. You are dismissed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.